Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the program. Our football expert, Santana Dotson. Good morning, Santana. How are you? I'm sorry. Santana, how are you?
I'm good. How's it going, fellas?
Very well. Well, that's a lie. It's not going very well.
We're happy to have a win, although it was tough to watch the game.
Yeah.
It's a win.
Yeah,
it and it's like, a it division
like watching,
win.
It was like watching grass grow, huh?
Well, even Aaron Rodgers said afterwards that he wasn't happy with the tempo of it or the execution. It was, you know, but it was just hard to watch.
But it wasn't like watching the grass grow, Santana, because it was on fake turf in a dome.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Lions, you know, the Lions aren't going to be happy with that game because they lost. But they seemed like they were moving the ball. And it was like, God, how are we going to stop these guys? And it was nerve-wracking.
Well, I mean, every so often you go into one of those games and you gotta find a way, you know. And that was one of those find a way to win games.
Yeah, it was.
And it may be ugly, but you know the good thing you pull away from it is we found somebody to make a play, and we found a way to win this game, and you know put it in the archive.
What was the ugliest game you ever played in that you got out of there with a win, and you were going, "Geez, shouldn't have been that tough."
It was probably one much of the same. I remember going to St. Louis, and that's before they were very good, and they might have been 1-8 or 2-7, one of those type teams, and it was supposed to be one of those automatics, but we had a few injuries, and we had to fight our way through, and I think Doug Evans ended up catching a interception, which gave the offense a short field, and we were able to get out of there with a quick field goal or a quick score. But, yeah, there are always one or two ugly games each year that you come away feeling good about it because you're like, we weren't supposed to win that game. We didn't do enough to win that game, but we found a way to get a victory.
What, let's see, they had about 440 or 450 when they got the ball for the last time, the Packers.
Oh, yeah. When they scored the touchdown.
I thought they scored too quickly. I thought, oh, my God, they're... Sure. They've scored in too little time. The Lions are going to come back and shove it down their throats.
Right. That's right.
I mean,
I think it had us all a little bit nervous. You want to score, but you want that clock to tick, too, at the same time. The clock becomes your friend late in the fourth quarter.
But then you have to put yourselves in the seat of a Lions fan who have watched the Lions play for the last 20, 30 years going, they're not going to do anything with the ball. And they didn't do anything with the ball. They came out, it was 4-and-out. It wasn't even close. I thought what they should have done rather than going for it on fourth down, and I tweeted this, was try an 87-yard field goal with Jason Hansen. Because they were only down by one at that time. And, you know, for as much good as that fourth down play did them, the 87-yard field goal wouldn't have been crazy.
Now, do you line up in the same spot for that kind of a kick, or do you give yourself more of a run-up?
I'm not sure.
Because I don't think in three steps you're going to get enough leg into that.
Maybe he takes – but you've got to get it off quick, right, Santana?
Oh, yeah, you definitely have to get it off quick. Yeah, well, I don't even know how you practice that.
87-yard.
All right, line up for our 87-yard field goal attempt here. We're going to practice this.
Talk to Chris Jackie anymore?
Yeah, I see him every so often at events. He's still in the Wisconsin area. I think he's still in Green Bay.
Do you talk to him more now than you did when you were playing? Because you guys didn't mingle with punters. You guys always sat on the bench. You were always on the top rail. Or kickers, place kickers.
Yeah, we didn't really talk to kickers. And I mean, you may visit with them during the week, but on Sunday, it's one of those things that you just want them to do their job. You want them to do their job, so you don't want to distract them. You just want them to stay focused. So usually you don't catch many, you know, offensive, defensive linemen or any players really talking to kickers.
I personally think there should be a cup on the Gatorade table that the kickers and punters have to drop a quarter in when they get a cup of Gatorade. Because what do they need Gatorade for during a game?
They're working. They're kicking into that net.
I like that one. That's a good idea.
What about Mason Crosby?
Did you see Jennings, like, slapping him in the head and trying to get him to loosen up a little bit?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I think trying to loosen him up. He's been so good for the team for so long. And, you know, kicking is one of those things that it is not a defined art, you know. So it kind of comes and goes, and he's really in the valley. And I think you really see folks wanting to cheer him on, wanting to do want to do well because he's been one of those guys that he's been good for the Packers for so long that you want him to come around by the time the playoffs come.
What would I mean? How irritating was it for you guys when you know you guys had done your jobs, the offense had done their jobs, and it came down to a kicker and he missed it? That's his one thing, and in pretty much makeable situations inside, right? I mean, what do you say to him, or do you have any sympathy for him?
Exactly. Well, you know, as a defender, again, we don't as a defensive player, we don't say a lot to him, and we don't have a lot to do with it. But you know, especially talking to the offensive players. You know, offensively, you hate to leave it in the kicker's hands because, again, it's an undefined art. So, you know, a lot of times as an offensive player, those guys are really wishing that they would have scored. You know, and even when the kicker comes on the field, sometimes you feel like it's almost a letdown because you want to put six or seven on the board, and when you're kicking threes, it's almost like you're settling as an offensive player. So most of the times, you know. The offensive guys kind of dejected when the kicker takes the field in the first place because, as always, they feel like it was either a mental error or a lapse that that didn't allow them to score the touchdown.
What about the M.D. Jennings interception? Why, when I was watching that, it set me back to a time when maybe a younger Santana Dotson could have run like that with the football.
Run like the wind.
Right.
He was jumping and running, wind in his hair.
I tell you what, just watching that thing, I think I pulled a ham. I need a bag of ice.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a long return, too. He had to go. I thought, great, interception. I never thought touchdown when he grabbed it.
Yeah, I never thought that either. You thought surely somebody would get in his way and kind of trip.
Right. Yeah. I was yelling at the TV before that for a pick six, but it was too far in advance to say it had anything to do. There was no magic in that TV yelling. Just happened.
Yeah. Where do you go on a play like that if you're on the field, Santana? There's a defensive back like a water bug out there running. You know, he's got a little help from other D-backs out there on the field. Do you just kind of stop and watch?
No, we used to say there was one of those years that we led the league in like NFL defensive touchdowns or something crazy. But believe it or not, we used to practice it. So, you know, when a guy caught an interception, like a linebacker or a DB, we would always set up a wall, like, to the closest numbers to the sideline where he caught it, so he'd kind of know where to go and run that ball. So we actually practiced it a little bit.
Yeah, but you're the guy who told us that you don't go running into the end zone after the guy to congratulate him because after the kickoff, you're going to be right back out there.
Yeah, exactly. That's a lazy man's way of thinking. I just admit that. But, hey.
You didn't say it was lazy man's when you told us that. You said that was a veteran move.
Yeah, that was just what the veterans do.
Hey, I still stand behind that statement. Don't get me wrong.
All right, Packers go to New York now. They've got a 5-game winning streak. The Giants, they were off yesterday, weren't they?
The Giants have a bye week, and they've been kind of in the valley for a little while. So I think it's going to be a big game. You know, we all know who sent us packing last year. So we've got a right or wrong, and we get a chance to do it next week in New York.
And it's a Sunday night game, so it's a national game. The world will see this game.
And the whole world is watching.
How tough is it to get ready for these short weeks if you're Houston and you're going to Detroit or you're the Redskins and you're headed to Dallas, you know, for Thanksgiving Day games?
Well, I always say that the advantage is to the home team because they actually get an extra day of preparation and they don't have to travel. You know, you look at it now, if you're the Texans, you don't get an off day. You're going right back to work today, and they just played a game yesterday at noon. An overtime game, exactly. So not only are you physically worn out and beat up from the game, but you're also mentally exhausted. So you got to try to throw that one out your mind and prepare for Detroit on Monday, Tuesday. You're going to travel. You won't do any practicing on Wednesday because that's your travel day. And then you'll be going to kick that ball off Thursday at 11, 12 o'clock. So, you know, it's always an advantage to the home team. You know, but that being said, that's the life in the NFL. So you got to do what you can do and try to put your best foot forward to get that victory.
Although traveling to Detroit from Green Bay, I mean, you know, it's an hour, right?
Yeah, I think it's like a 45-minute, 50-minute flight.
Right.
And then, you know, as Packers, we were used to that game. I think it's going to be real brand new, just a short week and being on a national stage for the Texans. So. Yeah. it'll almost be another trap game. They had a shootout yesterday against Jacksonville that, you know, a Jacksonville team that they were supposed to easily beat. So I think it's going to be another tough game, and it'll probably entertain a bunch of folks on Thanksgiving.
What are you having for Thanksgiving?
You know what? I have not decided yet. I don't know if I'm going old school or trying to just something with a new twist on it. What are you guys doing?
I would go with the new thing. Innovate. Plow new ground.
I'm trying something new, Santana.
Beer can turkey or something like that.
You did the beer can chicken.
So you're thinking beer can turkey?
Well, it'd probably be coffee can turkey.
You're an innovator.
Bird.
You're an innovator. You'll figure it out. Come on now. Here we go.
Are people coming over?
Actually, it's just family and close friends. So it's not a big to-do this year. Thanksgiving just kind of jumped up on everybody. Actually, I was talking to my mom and sister yesterday, and they're like, not yesterday, but last week, and they were like, oh, by the way, it's Thanksgiving next Thursday. What do you guys want to do?
Yep, you got to get the deep fryer out or decide if you're going to do the infrared or if you're going to, like you said, go old school and throw it in the oven at 6 o'clock in the morning. You can cook it upside down. What are you going to do?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. All right, we'll figure it out.
All right, fellas. Well, y'all have a good Thanksgiving.
Santana, same to you.